It's a new day dawning. The time is at hand where the glory of the Lord will be revealed to every man. Open the door. Open the door. Open the door. And let the King of Glory in.
Let the King of Glory in. Open up the doors. Starts right now. So fling wide you heavenly gates and prepare the way of the risen Lord. The Apostle John was on the island of Patmos. He was in prison for the testimony of Jesus Christ. And he heard a sound behind him, and he said, I looked, and there was a door standing open in heaven. And I heard a voice which was like a trumpet speaking with me, saying, come up here, and I will show you the things which must take place. That's what we need, my friends. We need a heavenly perspective of the things that are going on in the world around us. The things that the Word of God foretold us would come to pass, those things which must take place, those things which are taking place even now. That is what this broadcast is all about, discussing the issues of the day and discerning the times in which we live from a biblical perspective and worldview. Good afternoon, everybody. Andy White here. And what you are about to hear is the fusion of heart, mind, and soul. And I want to welcome everybody from all across the fruited plain and all around the spherical globe. Thanks for joining in to this week's edition of Open Up the Doors. Hey, do me a favor. If you are tuned in, if you are listening in, I am streaming live over my Facebook Live page over at facebook.com/faithfm91.7. If you are there watching over there on Facebook Live, please share this to your streams. Please share this to your social media streams. Invite people to Open Up the Doors. Let people know about the broadcast. If you've never liked my Open Up the Doors page, please like the page as well. I'm looking for as much of an interactive experience that I could possibly have here on Open Up the Doors. And I need you, my audience, to be actively engaged, helping me out with that. So please shoot me your comments and your input on the Facebook stream, and I will try and address any questions or share any input that you might have as well as I glance at that stream ever so often. And let me know where you're watching from as well. I got people from Ohio and East End of Long Island here as well, and Wisconsin. God bless everybody. Thanks for joining in. Of course. Well, it's June 18th, 2020, unless you happen to be listening to the replay of this on Saturday, then it's June 20th. So often I forget about mentioning the fact that it is rebroadcast. This broadcast is re-aired on Saturdays, but it's the middle of June of 2020, and what a progression of events that we've been experiencing this year. Can somebody say amen on Facebook? It's been a roller coaster ride. I've been saying that like every week, it seems like. It's been a progressive leftist cornucopia dream, what's going on these last several months. You know, as always, I have so much on my plate that I want to share, and I always get perplexed because I know I'm not going to get to everything that I would really like to. But before I even begin with what I've got laid out on the palette, I want to put into your mind a picture that comes out from Daniel chapter 3. In Daniel chapter 3, we read about where Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, built an idol, made an image of himself. The Bible tells us in Daniel chapter 3, and I don't want to take the time to read all through that, but I'm going to condense the story because with everything I say today and share today, I want that image to be in the back of your mind about how the spirit of the age wants us to bow down to the image of the beast. Because this is what, in Daniel chapter 3, let me back up a minute. This image that Nebuchadnezzar builds to himself, the king of Babylon, is really a type of the image of the beast that is to come in the last days. This image that Nebuchadnezzar built was 60 cubits high and 6 cubits wide, 60 and 6. Again, there's this shadowing, this foreshadowing of the ultimate image of the beast to come at the end of days. There's a picture there. And you know the story in Daniel chapter 3, I think most of you. They were all, the kingdom of Nebuchadnezzar, Babylon, and we read about a last days Babylon, of course, in the book of Revelation 17 and 18, the mystery Babylon. So there's a lot of pictures and foreshadowings that are going on here in Daniel chapter 3. But Nebuchadnezzar calls together all of the governors of all the provinces and all the satraps, and they were kind of like governors too, and all of the ruling authorities from around the kingdom, hundreds and hundreds, probably thousands, to gather around this image. And the Bible tells us that at the sound of the lute and the lyre and the flute and the psaltery, you shall fall down and bow down. You shall take a knee, if you will, to this statue of Nebuchadnezzar. And a herald went out proclaiming throughout the land that everyone was commanded to bow down when they heard the sound of the lute and the lyre and the psaltery. In other words, there was to be this jubilation. There was to be this musical festive. It was supposed to be a festive gathering. Like, oh, we're just having a great time here, and Nebuchadnezzar is such a great king here, and he's ruling over our kingdom, and we're just going to bow down to everything that Nebuchadnezzar is doing for us and for our land. And by the way, if you don't, you're going to be thrown into the fiery furnace. But we'll leave that part aside right now, because we know everybody's going to bow down. Everybody's going to take the knee to the spirit of the age, because it's the command of the king. It's the rule and the law of the land to take a knee, take a knee, take a knee. Except there was these three guys. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego said, sorry, king. We're not going to bow down to the zeitgeist. We're not going to bow down to your image. We're not going to bow down, king. Whatever, you know, come what may. Do what you have to do with us. And they got thrown in the fiery furnace. You know the story. But here's my point right now. I want you to understand, as I've been saying for weeks on end now, that what is going on in the world right now, on every single level, is a preconditioning for the world to bow down to the image of the beast, the king of Babylon, which is to come. So I want that to be in your mind as I share the things I'm sharing today, because you might say, what does that got to do with anything? It's the spirit of the age, my friends. You know, as I said a moment ago, here we are in 6 months into 2020, and we've seen back in January, 2020 kicked off with the travesty of the impeachment. And that transitioned into the tragedy of the pandemic. And that turned into the tumult of the riotous protests and the pandemonium that we saw break out across our country in recent weeks. And now we're witnessing, from the impeachment to the pandemic to the pandemonium, now we're witnessing, my friends, what I would suggest to you is a twisted and dystopian form of pandering that is going on in our nation right now. Pandering to the spirit of the age. Pandering to the lawlessness. There's a pandering that's going on from the corporate world, which I'll get into in a few more moments of this broadcast. But there's a pandering that's coming from the corporate world. A pandering that's coming from the governing officials, all the way up to the Supreme Court. The pandering and the knee bending has taken on a life of its own, my friends. And trust me, it's only just begun. As this year's election season begins to pick up steam, assuming there's going to be an election season in this crazy year of 2020, the pandering is going to get even worse. Again, I'm just glancing over at my comment stream here. If anybody wants to add anything to this, please feel free. But having said all that, by way of introduction, I want to back up. I want to back up a bit, because it's all related. You might not think it's related. You might not think these things are dovetailing together, but they are. Because in the meantime, what we've been seeing in all of this, and what is continuing, is For instance, the media, the media coronavirus doomsayers are frantically. Have you been looking at the Drudge Report lately? It's really just become such a pot of negativism all the time. I don't know whatever happened there with Drudge, but I digress. But these media coronavirus doomsayers are frantically trying to convince us day after day that the pandemic has not gone away, despite the fact that we've been seeing tens of thousands of people massing together in these protests all over the country. And yet, there hasn't been any evidence of a huge resurgence, and those are the operative words, a huge resurgence of cases, of coronavirus cases. Now, I'll admit the media keeps harping on, they keep going on and on and on and on and on about new cases in order to keep the fear narrative alive. But that really is a continuing manipulation of the data by the media and really a meaningless metric anyway, because the issue has always been about the fear of the hospitals, my friends, being overrun. And they are not. The overwhelming trend, and this is the fact of the matter, the overwhelming trend of cases is downward and plummeting, despite some blips here and there along the way. Are there some spikes here and there? Yeah, they are. But there are spikes in the downward trend. I saw a graph just the other day that really laid this out well. So again, it's the media is just continuing with the narrative and the fear-mongering because they got to keep the pandemonium going. You know, and I'm telling you, they're really trying their very, very best. And they're even telling us that there's a second wave coming that's going to be worse than the first wave. And quite honestly, I don't believe any of that. But we'll see. We'll see. Let me go by the official narrative that they're giving us. So according to the official narrative, the pandemic is still with us. Therefore, they will keep pandering to our fears about the pandemic while ignoring the pandemonium of the anarchists and protesters thereby. It's like putting a, you know, the shell game. You know, which shell is the, you know, the item under, the object, the token under, the object under, which they're just shifting shells around to keep us all off balance. But, you know, according to them, the pandemic is still with us. Therefore, they'll keep pandering to our fears about the pandemic while ignoring the pandemonium of the anarchists and protesters, thereby fueling the fires of the lawlessness that they are pandering to. It's really quite an Orwellian logic, or something like that anyway. That's just the kind of year we're having. But I want to remind you, it's all in keeping with the spirit of the age. America is bending the knee to the spirit of the age all across the fruited plain. I might say, welcome to Pandorama. We've got spineless governors and mayors bending the knee to the anarchists, the rioters, and the militant activists. We've got so-called woke white folk bending the knee to black folk, asking for forgiveness for slavery. Yeah, we do. People who were never slave owners are asking forgiveness from people who were never slaves. It's like they forgot we fought a civil war over this stuff 150, 160 years ago. But these so-called woke people, man, they are so seriously maleducated. Maleducated woke people. That's an oxymoron for you. And I doubt any of them have ever read a legitimate history book. These people who think that slavery was a uniquely American institution. These people who somehow don't seem to know that slavery existed for thousands and thousands of years, way before America ever existed. And many of these idiots, and that's what I'm calling, I'm going to call them what they are, they're idiots. Idiots are in Congress. Some of these idiots are in Congress, like Senator Tim Kaine. Did you hear what Senator Tim Kaine said the other day? Did you catch what he said in a speech on the Senate floor this past Tuesday? You know, the Senator Tim Kaine, the guy that ran as Hillary Clinton's running mate when she was running for president. Senator Tim Kaine blamed the United States, specifically the Virginia General Assembly, for quote-unquote inventing slavery. I almost fell out of my chair when I saw that video clip. Let me quote to you from Senator Tim Kaine. The United States didn't inherit slavery from anybody. We created it. What? Let me read that again. Because this is like mind-boggling stupidity. The United States didn't inherit slavery from anybody. We created it. Does this guy know that the American Native Indians, the Native Americans that were in America, doesn't he know that they had slaves here before even the pilgrims came? Slavery has existed since the dawn of time. These people, my eyes want to shoot out blood. Will somebody please show them a history book? Don't they know that the Apache Indian put Sioux Indian into slavery, and the Sioux Indian put Cherokee Indian into slavery? Now I'm just generalizing right now, but there was slavery, there was cannibalism here in America by the indigenous Indians. Hello? But according to Tim Kaine, the United States didn't inherit slavery from anybody. We created it. Quote, it got created by the Virginia General Assembly and the legislatures of other states. This is so historically insane. It's absolutely mind-boggling. And these are our leaders? These people have an incessant habit of misrepresenting facts. They will oftentimes cite quote-unquote facts without their proper context and declare smugly that, quote, we're just stating the facts. But no. What they are actually doing is misrepresenting and abusing the facts. Because, folks, facts without their proper context are misleading at best and often open to abuse at worst. Because historical context matters. Repeat after me. Everybody's got a mantra today. All lives matter. Black lives matter. Historical context matters. That is what almost all of these not really white folk are manifestly ignorant of. Furthermore, let me add to that rant. To put today's societal standards on people that lived centuries ago is simply further evidence of moralistic sophistry and ignorance. Again, I'm just glancing over at my comment stream here. One brother said, every country had slave, but only one country fought to free them. Thank you for that comment, brother. But actually, yes, we fought to freedom with the Civil War. England outlawed slavery as well, but they did it without a Civil War. But you're right. You know, this is just the twisting of history to recreate a narrative. And these so-called white folk, woke folk, but they're white, most of them, these liberal elites, they don't seem to have any knowledge about the African slave trade at all. They don't seem to have any knowledge about how Arabs and black Africans were enslaving people for centuries, well before America existed. But you know, Senator Tim Kaine said, we created slavery. I'm sorry, Senator. You're either really stupid or you're pretending to be really stupid. Despite years of Black History Februaries, many still know little to nothing about the vast role played by Arab and Muslim slave traders in the African slave trade. The slave trade, I'll say it again, began centuries before the Europeans bought and transported slaves out of Africa. And by the way, the white Europeans were buying them from black North Africans. Go and watch the movie Amistad. I've talked about that movie on the broadcast in the past. Great, awesome movie. But these self-proclaimed paragons of virtue, you know, the woke generation, They never mention that right now, today, there are still an estimated 40 million slaves in the world. Did you know that? I was astonished when I read that stat. I actually went back and double and triple checked it. That's a lot. There are an estimated 40 million slaves in the world today, mostly in Arab and Muslim nations. Oh, that's why they don't mention it too much. Although North Korea is number one. North Korea is the leading slave nation in the world. But I digress a little bit. But folks, right now, we've got mayors and governors bending the knee to radical activists who are only using these issues to further a leftist radical agenda. And we've got woke white folk bending the knee to black folk, as I said a moment ago, forgetting that we fought a civil war that ended in slavery in America, as another brother said here on the comment stream. And we've got a not-so-conservative Supreme Court now pandering to the zeitgeist as well, tragically, with all of their recent decisions to almost every leftist cause the zeitgeist is offering up to them. Pandering is going on everywhere. And I want to tell you something. Don't forget that all of these forces coalescing and coming together are trying to see if they can get you and me to bend the knee to the image as well. They're coming together to see if they can get President Trump to bend his knee as well to them. But that remains to be seen. But I wouldn't hold my breath. Again, with this election season, as it heats up, what we're gonna have from politicians, both left and right, pandering is going to be going on like crazy. Wait till you see the stuff even Republicans are going to start pandering to because of the power of the zeitgeist, the spirit of the age. They're going to be bending the knee to all these radical leftist ideas that they can latch onto. And you know why, folks? You know why? Because they're cowards. There's a spirit of cowardness that's working together side by side. It's interesting when you read the book of Revelation, at the end of the book of Revelation, that those who are thrown in the lake of fire, there's a list there, and the first on the list are cowards. Did you ever wonder about that? They're cowards because they feared the zeitgeist, and they bent the knee to the image of the beast, the spirit of Antichrist. That is what all of this is about. All these little things that are going on, that's what this is about, my friends. The spirit of lawlessness, the spirit of cowards. And speaking of cowards, I got to touch upon a little bit what's going on in Seattle. Because Seattle has become ground zero for mindless wokeness. Got to talk about Chaz or Chop now because Chaz changed their name to Chop. Because let me give you a little bit of the update from the latest updates from the epicenter of pandering. You know, I was kind of bummed. I was a little bit bummed when I found out that the Chasmanians changed their name to CHOP. CHOP means Capitol Hill Occupied Protest. Because really what happened, the Capitol Hill Autonomous Zone, when they started running out of supplies, they decided they didn't want to be autonomous anymore. Oh, we never meant we wanted to be autonomous. So I was going to dub them the Chasmanian Devils, and they kind of took the wind out of my sails by changing their name. So I guess Chasmanian Devil is out. But now maybe I'll just call them Chop Soviets. Because they want to make their little kingdom of Chop there like the Soviet Union. I'm not making this up. They want to be the Soviet Union. I mean, this really should be a theater of the absurd spot. But I think the whole broadcast is going to be like this. So the Soviet Union, because it's a union of Antifa and Black Lives Matter and this new group I told you about last week, I think it was last week, RAM, and the Democratic Socialists of America, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. All of these radical left-wing groups are coming together to create their capital city on Capitol Hill, the Soviet Union. The other night I'm watching Tucker Carlson, and he referred to the citizens of Chop as Chopistanis. That's kind of cool. I kind of like that. I wanted to call them Chop Sueys. Well, no, not Sueys. Not Chop Suey. That's from China. I'm getting my nomenclature messed up. I wanted to call them Chop Soyies. That's what I wanted to call them. Although I admit Chopistanis has a certain ring to it. But Chop Suey is appropriate, really. You know, kind of a play on Chop Suey. Because really what these folks are doing is so reminiscent of the Chinese Maoist Cultural Revolution. That's what we're experiencing, my friend, with all of this changing of history, with all of these tearing down of these monuments, with all this changing of everything. And I'm going to get into Aunt Jemima and Uncle Ben's and a couple of these things as the program progresses. But I've got to go to a break because, wow, I can't believe what time it is already. So I'm going to have to break this off. I've got so much here to get into. Some of it, it's almost funny, and it would be funny if it wasn't so serious. It's ridiculous, the stuff that's going on. I got so much more to share with you. But I want to tell you, before I go to my break, I want to say this. It's all about the zeitgeist, the spirit of the age, preconditioning, and preparing people to ultimately bend the knee to the image of the beast. That's where this is heading downstream. Mark my words. But as for me, the only person I'm ever going to bow my knee to is the Lord Jesus Christ. I'll be right back, my friends. Here's Chris Tomlin. All bow down. Chris Tomlin, classic actually, one of his earlier albums, All Bow Down. All bow down to the Lord Jesus Christ, but not to the image of the beast as I'm talking about on this edition of Open Up the Doors. I want to get right back into some of the stuff I'm sharing here. Some of it's comical actually. Remember when Mike Bloomberg was running for president during his campaign? Mike Bloomberg condescendingly said, anybody can farm. To quote him more directly, he said, if you think about it, the agrarian society lasted 3,000 years, and we can teach processes. I can teach anybody, even people in this room, so no offense intended, I can teach anybody to be a farmer. No, you can't. It's a process. You dig a hole, you put a seed in it, you put dirt on top, you add water, up comes the corn. You can learn that. Except the Chopistanis. Did you see what they did? Oh, yes, for their Soviet revolution, they wanted to grow some soy and some other things there. So what they did is they took a bunch of cardboard boxes, they flattened them out, and they put these cardboard boxes on top of the grass in some grassy section. I guess it was a park or something. But they took these flattened boxes and they put them on top of the grass, and then they dumped topsoil on top of the boxes. And I saw the video of this. And then they put the plants in the topsoil, which was probably only about maybe an inch or two deep, which underneath was cardboard boxes. And they were going to start this co-op, farming adventure. Hey, folks. There's your public school tax dollars at work. Now, what was the first thing? Talk about a state of cognitive dissonance coming from these folks there in Chopistan over there in Seattle. Because here we have it, my friends. Pretty much everything that the left has complained about and condemned America about, they are now literally doing themselves in the occupied territory of Seattle. The first thing they did when they took over the six-block area was to set up a wall and a fence barrier. Yet for the last several years, the left has been telling us that walls are racist. The second thing they did was to tell people that they needed to show ID if they wanted to enter into Chaz/CHOP. Well, wait a minute. I thought having people show ID was racist. Remember how we were all told that quote-unquote stop and frisk was racist? Remember when Mike Bloomberg was pandering and repented and said he was sorry for the stop and frisk policies that were going on in New York because stop and frisk was racist? Well, upon entering into CHOP, my friends, you got it. Stop and frisks by armed thugs are necessary at various checkpoints. Yes, indeedy. Third, then they ask people to come and join them and come in with guns to help guard the perimeter. Wait, what? Aren't these the same folks that have been demonstrating all these years to ban guns? Haven't they been telling us that the Second Amendment is outdated and needs to be repealed and that only the police should have guns? But I forgot they've banned the police, you know, because they're oppressive and all. Again, the state of cognitive dissonance. Everything they've been complaining about, everything they've been condemning us about, they themselves are doing. And in the meantime, and here's where it gets really, really makes your blood boil. In the meantime, the feckless and fearful governor of Washington State and the mayor of Seattle keep piling on the pandering. And the mayor, when confronted with the situation, called it the summer of love. You know, as I've watched the numerous raw footage videos coming out from CHOP, I need to tell you, my blood begins to boil, my friends, over the fact that the mayor and governor is allowing this lawless and disgusting exhibition to continue because they are obviously utterly clueless as to what they are dealing with. But they are bending the knee like cowards. They're bending the knee to the spirit of the age. But not only them. That same spirit of Antichrist is demanding everyone take a knee. And as I said a moment ago at the top of the show, the world is being preconditioned right now to take a knee, to bow down to the spirit of Antichrist. This virtue signaling that's going on. So now, I'm sure most of you have heard about this. I've got to touch upon this. Because here's another twisting of historical accounting and records. The PepsiCo company that sells, it's the unit that sells the Aunt Jemima products, you know, maple syrup, Aunt Jemima pancakes. Well, they said they would retire the brand because of its origins in racist imagery of black people. Kristen Croffle, chief marketing officer at PepsiCo's Quaker Foods North American business, said in a statement, quote, "We recognize Aunt Jemima origins are based on a racial stereotype. While work has been done over the years to update the brand in a manner intended to be appropriate and respectful, we realize those changes are not enough." Again, just like Senator Tim Kaine, it's another mindless, pure, mindless, vacuous statement devoid of any historical accuracy. Did you know that Aunt Jemima actually was a real person? Well, Nancy Green. How many here ever heard of Nancy Green? Nancy Green was the face of Aunt Jemima. Nancy Green was the promoter of the maple syrup when they first came out. I did a little bit of research because that's what I like to do. But Nancy Green was a former slave. Nancy Green was born into slavery as a child. Well, we're all born as children, of course, but she was born into slavery. But the Davis Milling Company, which first created the pancake mix, made Nancy Green both famous and rich. Nancy Green won a competition because they were looking for someone to be a spokesperson for the pancake mix. But these vacuous morons who are bending the knee, they never do their homework. They never bother to look at the real story behind the image. They did the same thing with the Indian girl in the Land O'Lakes butter. A family was so dismayed that they took that Indian off the Land O'Lakes butter logo because that was based on a real person, too. And the family was honored that was the logo for all these times. But all these companies, all these corporations, bowing to the spirit of the age. But it's about a real issue. It's not about a real issue, I should say, excuse me. It's just symbolism over substance to appease and pander to the Twitter mob. And these people never know the real history of anything that they are decrying or tearing down. But as Paul Harvey used to say, quote, and now for the rest of the story. Because all of this is about symbolism over substance and bowing down to the zeitgeist. So now for the rest of the story regarding Aunt Jemima and Nancy Green. In 1893, and I got this from her from a biography on her. In 1893, the Davis Milling Company aggressively began an all-out promotion of Aunt Jemima at the World's Columbian Exposition in Chicago. Green, Nancy Green, as Aunt Jemima, demonstrated the pancake mix and served thousands of pancakes. Green was a hit because she was friendly, she was a good storyteller, and she was, in fact, a good cook. And her warm and appealing personality made her the ideal Aunt Jemima. Her warm and appealing personality. Yes, that sounds very racist, doesn't it? She became a living trademark. And because of the time that I have, the time restrictions, I need to condense this. But her exhibition in Chicago drew so many people that special policemen were assigned to keep the crowds moving. The Davis Milling Company received over 50,000 orders right in the beginning. And the fair officials awarded Nancy Green a medal and certificate for her showmanship because, you know, they were just so racist. She was proclaimed the Pancake Queen. And get this, she was signed, because she was no longer a slave. This is the late 1800s. She was signed to a lifetime contract and traveled on promotional tours all over the country. She got rich. She went from being born a slave to becoming one of America's first black rich people, the Oprah Winfrey of her day. Flour sales were up all year and pancakes were no longer considered exclusively for breakfast. Playing the role of Aunt Jemima gave Nancy Green financial independence few African Americans and few women in general experienced at the time. Remember, historical context matters. And she used her wealth. Again, this is from a biography on her. She used her wealth as a means to empower her community. She was particularly active in a church. She led missionary trips. She invested in anti-poverty programs, all because she got rich promoting and happily doing it. She wasn't a slave anymore. She willingly signed a lifetime contract and got rich to promote Aunt Jemima. But now it's being taken down by the zeitgeist because of ignoramuses who think that everything done is racist. It's making me crazy, people. I'm hearing the same stories about Uncle Ben's now. I'm hearing Aunt Jemima, Nancy Green, she maintained this job from the late 1800s all the way up until September 23rd, 1923, when she was tragically killed in a car accident. The Davis Company, which was the original company that had Aunt Jemima and Aunt Jemima pancake mix, had money problems, and they eventually sold to Quaker Oats in 1925. So Quaker Oats now is saying it had racial roots. And they didn't even have this until after she died. This is craziness. This is absolute mindless insanity. Folks, never once in my entire life did I ever have a racial thought while having pancakes and syrup. As a matter of fact, that smiling and endearing face was rather heartwarming. These people, I'm sorry to say it, are just stupid. They might as well change the name of Quaker Oats, too, because, you know, Quakers have a religious stereotype. You know what's even ironic about this coming from this person saying that the origins of Aunt Jemima were all racist and born out of racist stereotypes, and Quaker Oats was selling these since 1925? Is that The Quakers, as a religious group, were the strongest abolitionists of the time. They were against racism. They were against slavery. They were abolitionists. None of this makes any sense whatsoever, my friends. Now, I bet, I'm going to go to a break right now, but I bet you never thought you would get a history lesson on Aunt Jemima, on Open Up the Doors. But it's all about the fusion of heart, mind, and soul here. In other words, it's all about the relentless pursuit of truth. Because as a Christian, we are bound to be in the business of truth and exposing the lies of the darkness. So stick around, my friends, because there's a whole lot more truth coming up after this. Here's a tune by Toby Mac called City on Our Knees. The fusion of heart, mind, and soul. This is Open Up the Doors with Andy White here on Faith FM. WEGB 90.7 and 93.3 in that peak. WEGQ 91.7 in Quag. And thanks, everybody, for joining in with me on this week's edition of Open Up the Doors. I am streaming live over my Facebook Live page. If you're just joining in, I've got a few more minutes left before the end of the broadcast. If you've never liked my Open Up the Doors Facebook page, please like the page over at facebook.com/FaithFM91.7. I also have a YouTube channel that I would love for you to subscribe to. Please go on over to YouTube. Just search for Andy White, Open Up the Doors, and subscribe to my YouTube channel. Also, click on the little bell, and you'll get notifications of when these broadcasts are uploaded to YouTube. We edit and produce all of these broadcasts and load them there on YouTube, as well as other materials which are a good reference and resource materials for you. That's what the YouTube channel is all about. So if you've never subscribed to my YouTube channel, I would ask you humbly to please subscribe to it. All right, I think I've got those things out of the way, and I've only got a few minutes left here, so let me get back to it. The pandering that's going on. We've gone from pandemic to pandemonium to now outright pandering. And, of course, one of the biggest panderers of all is New York City Mayor Bill de Blasio. Now, what he's planning on doing, I don't know if you heard about this, but he wants to go up. He wants to up Washington by five times. You know, back about several weeks back, the mayor of Washington wrote Black Lives Matter the city wrote Black Lives Matter in huge letters down at one of the Washington City streets. And you could see it, of course, from the aerial footage. But now Mayor de Blasio is planning to pander in a big way to the Black Lives Matter movement. And following the lead of Washington, D.C., Bill de Blasio announced last week that a street in all five boroughs, in other words, there'll be five of them, a street in every borough will be painted with the words Black Lives Matter. To quote Bill de Blasio, quote, "The streets of our city will now affirm the vital work activists have done to bring us forward." Really? I wonder if he's going to paint those big yellow letters, Black Lives Matter, down Fifth Avenue, where they burned down and busted up all the stores there down on Fifth Avenue. I wonder if he's going to put one of those paintings there, one of the street graffiti. That's what it amounts to. It amounts to street graffiti, Black Lives Matter. But de Blasio said, to continue with this quote, "We're going to affirm the work that these activists have done to bring us forward with a street in every borough painted with the words Black Lives Matter. We are recognizing where we have been." I'm not really sure about that. "And looking forward to where we will go." Definitely not looking forward to that. Folks, you see, here's the thing with this, as I'm running out of time. These people and these radical groups, and now we have national leaders paying homage and taking the knee to these radical groups. These people seek to deconstruct our culture based on their simplistic and vacuous moralizing. That's all it is. What will be left in the wake should they succeed? Tribalism, civil war, chaos, and anarchy. That's where we're going, Mr. de Blasio, if you keep pandering to the spirit and to this lawlessness. Because these people, they don't understand the culture that they despise. And they are incapable of building anything out of the wreckage that they will leave behind. And yet, they are being pandered to. But here's the thing. And here's the real thing I think we need to be careful of not losing sight of, my friends. It's this. That all these various groups are really nothing more. Hear me. All of these groups, as damaging and as lawless and as crazy as they are, they're really nothing more than the useful idiots of the real power brokers who are pulling their strings. The George Soroses of the world and others like them. These are the useful idiots. Now I want to really use my last few minutes by saying some things here to the church at large, particularly to church leaders. You know, the Apostle Paul wrote to the church at Colossae, and Paul wrote, "Beware, lest anyone cheat you through philosophy and empty deceit, according to the tradition of men, according to the basic principles of the world, and not according to Christ." There are a lot of virtue-signaling white people, and incredulously, even many highly sanctimonious white ministers and pastors who, having not done their due diligence and homework on the organization of Black Lives Matter, but they've simply latched on to a baited slogan, Black Lives Matter, and they have deceived themselves into thinking they are taking on some high moral stand. They take the bait, and that's what it is. They take the bait of an obviously true sentiment, Black Lives Matter. That's a true sentiment. But they ignore, willingly or ignorantly, the anti-biblical platform, the anti-biblical stance and agenda of the Black Lives Matter organizational movement. These pastors, and maybe you're one of them, these pastors and ministers who lock hands with BLM and support the movement have once again lost all sense of spiritual discernment and biblical fidelity in order to appease and appear righteous to men. And they've taken the bait. Because after all, how can you oppose that slogan? However, it's not the slogan nor the sentiment that one is opposing. That is really an obfuscation and a diversion from the real actual issue. As I said, Black Lives Matter. It's a loaded and baited slogan because morally, ethically, biblically, we already know and we already believe that all lives matter. Jesus died for the sins of the whole world. Hashtag all souls matter. But those ministers who choose to embrace the emotional manipulation of the slogan while ignoring the underlying falsehoods of both the narrative and especially the organization itself are in fact acquiescing to the spirit of Antichrist. How does any minister who claims fidelity to the Word of God stand or march with, or much less take a knee, to an organization that wants to abolish the nuclear family, an organization that wants population control through abortion, that advocates for radical LGBT and transgender agenda? How does any so-called Christian minister stand with an organization that clearly opposes every single biblical precept and principle? Paul tells us in Ephesians to have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather to expose them. Of course, as Christians, we ought to be fighting for justice for all. But that is not what BLM is all about. BLM and these other activist groups with a similar agenda are not about racism. They are about Marxism and communism. These people, folks, do not seek to have a serious or responsible conversation. They do not want to have a true reconciliation. They want to have a cultural revolution that tears down the Western Judeo-Christian society. They seek to deconstruct Western society through the destroying of a Judeo-Christian foundation. If you are a Christian, you ought not march, stand, kneel, or any such thing with these groups. Stand for and fight for the dignity, worth, and value of all people, yes, but do it from a biblical position and foundation, not from one that is actually looking to undermine it. For only in the gospel is there indeed true peace and reconciliation and justice, my friends. Make no mistake about it. Appeasement never works. I will stand with people seeking justice, but I will never genuflect to the spirit of the age. I will not take a knee to make the Twitter mob happy. And I'm out of time, and I've got to go. But know this, I will never bow the knee to the spirit of Antichrist. But let me assure you, my friends, that at the name of Jesus, every knee will one day bow, of those in heaven, and of those on the earth, and of those under the earth. I gotta go. But I got so much more to say, so come back next week for another edition of Open Up the Doors.